Hi guys, and thank you so much for joining me. If you are new here, I'm Kat, and I usually talk about true crime, conspiracies, and all sorts of related things. In today's video, let's talk about Katherine Knight. But before we get started, however, trigger warning, this video might contain some gruesome information and details, so if you are triggered by any of that, now is the time to step away and stop watching this video. Thank you so much. And also, my disclaimer, all the information that I'm giving you today is already found in the public domain, and also my personal opinions as well. I don't mean to be disrespectful to anyone I talk in today's video. The video is only for educational and entertainment purposes. Thank you. So, let's get started. Born on 14th of October 1955 in Tenterfield, Australia, Katherine was the result of an affair between her mother, Barbara Rugan, and her father, Ken Knight. Barbara was already a mother of four boys with another man and lived in the small town of Aberdeen in New South Wales, Hunter Valley. But she then met Ken, a friend and co-worker of her husband. When their secret affair came to light, it rocked the whole town, and they were forced to move out of Aberdeen, so they settled in Moree. Barbara's great-grandmother was an Indigenous Australian from the Moree area who married an Irishman. Barbara was proud of this fact and identified as Aboriginal. This was kept a family secret, as there was considerable racism in the area at the time, and this was a source of tension for the children. Apart from her twin sister, the only person whom Katherine was close to was her uncle, Oscar Knight, who was a champion horseman. She was devastated when he committed suicide in 1969 and continues to maintain that his ghost visits her. The family moved back to Aberdeen the same year. Following this start, Katherine's childhood didn't get much better. Her father was a violent alcoholic who raped her mother multiple times a day. Katherine herself claims she was sexually assaulted by several family members until the age of 11, but not by her father. In school, Katherine was known as a bully who terrorized small children. Without ever learning how to read or write, she quit at the age of 15 to work at a clothing factory. A year later, she landed her dream job at a slaughterhouse, cutting out the internal organs of animals. According to journalist Peter Leller, Katherine loved her job so much that she hung her first set of butcher's knives over her bed, just in case she ever needed them. Oh my God, I'm just trying to picture this. So, no picturing here. While working in the butcher shop, Katherine meets David Kellett, an alcoholic, much like her father. Used to this kind of violence, Katherine surprised her new boyfriend when she joined in on one of his drunken fights. He soon realized, however, that Katherine was capable of doing more than just a little damage with her fists. Very soon, he found himself being dominated by her, which is very unusual for aggressive alcoholics, if I'm honest. Usually, the aggressive alcoholics are the ones dominating their partner. In 1974, she convinced him to marry her. He was heavily drunk the entire time, and her mother even warned him about her daughter's temper, saying that Katherine had a loose screw. On their wedding night, Katherine and David consummated their marriage three times. When he fell asleep, she wanted a fourth round and had an issue with her new husband's exhaustion, so she started to strangle him. That's a good start to the marriage. David woke up and managed to fight her off, and although she tried to kill him, only one day into their marriage, the relationship lasted for 10 more years. The marriage was, however, far from perfect. Now you gotta imagine this, marrying someone, you marry your husband, and in the first night, you try to strangle him because he couldn't have another round of sex with you, a fourth round at that, with you. That's in your first night of marriage. But then, this man stays married with you for 10 more years. Oh my God, if I would be in that man's shoes, I would be even scared to fall asleep at night, thinking that whatever would set her off would just strangle him again. My God. David was, however, often unfaithful. And one time he even left his wife and their two daughters in the middle of the night. After discovering one of David's affairs, Katherine placed their two-month-old infant on the local train tracks shortly before a train was due. Luckily, the train didn't come and the baby was spared. She also threatened several people with a stolen axe. Do you think that she would have left that baby on the train tracks if the train would approach them? It was lucky for the baby that there was no train that night, but I mean, I don't know, at this point, I have no idea what kind of woman she is. Just out of spite, because her husband was unfaithful. Katherine was also diagnosed with postnatal depression after witnesses saw her violently pushing and swinging her second child in a stroller down a busy street. She spent a few months in a psychiatric hospital where she told nurses she intended to kill a mechanic who fixed David's car because that made it possible for him to leave her. Even with this threat, David took Katherine back when she was released from the hospital. That didn't last long, and when Katherine went through a period of deep distress, David finally left her. In 1986, shortly after her breakup, Katherine Knight jumped into a romance with David Saunders, a local miner. Coincidentally, her ex-husband was called David as well. Within a few months, I'm going to refer to the second husband by his last name so there is no confusion. Specifically because both of her husbands have got the first name as David. So his second, her second husband, I'll refer to him by his last name Saunders. Within a few months, Saunders moved in with her at her and her two daughters. However, he kept his apartment and Katherine became incredibly jealous and suspicious about what he did when she wasn't there. Like her previous relationships, this one quickly grew toxic and violent. At one point, she slit the throat of his two-month-old dingo puppy in front of him to show him what she was capable of. But they stayed together and even had a daughter 1 year later. David Saunders left Katherine shortly after the birth because she tried to kill him with a pair of scissors. She then meets a man named John Chillingworth. They stayed together for 3 years and have a child, Eric, Katherine's first son. While there were no violent incidents in their relationship, it ended after John Chillingworth learned that Katherine was having an affair with a man named John Price. The beginning of Katherine Knight and John Price's relationship was without any complications. He had two older children who lived with him and they seemed to like Katherine, and he made enough money as a miner to keep her comfortable. They moved in together in 1995 and things were going smoothly. However, when she suggested they marry and he declined, she turned violent. Katherine then framed John Price for stealing things from his company and got him fired. He initially kicked Katherine out, but a few months later, they started seeing each other again. This time, however, he refused to let her move back in. According to their friends and neighbors, Katherine's violence began to escalate. In February of 2000, an argument between John Price and Katherine Knight culminated in her attempting to stab him in the chest. He took out a restraining order against her in an attempt to keep his children safe. By the end of the month, John Price let on that he was concerned for his safety and told his co-workers if he ever went missing, it was because Katherine Knight killed him. On 29th of February 2000, John Price comes home from work and follows his usual routine of checking in with the neighbors before going to bed at 11 p.m. Katherine Knight comes home shortly after, makes herself dinner, watches some TV, showers, and then goes upstairs. She wakes John Price up, the two of them have sex, and he goes back to sleep. Then, Katherine Knight takes a butcher knife from next to her bed, where she always kept them, and stabs John Price 37 times. According to evidence, he woke up during the attack, but could not fight her off. He eventually died, and Katherine Knight dragged his body downstairs, skinned him, and hung his body from a meat hook in the living room. Then she decapitated him and cut up pieces of his body to cook in a dish with potato, pumpkin, beets, zucchini, cabbage, squash, and gravy. She then made a dish for herself, though the half-discarded contents later found that the crime scene suggests that she couldn't finish her meal. She then lay down next to the headless, mutilated corpse of John Price, took a large number of pills, and passed out. John Price's co-workers listened to his warning the next morning and called the police after he didn't show up for his shift. The police arrived to find Katherine's night crime scene and immediately detained the comatose Katherine. Once she woke up, she claimed to have no memory of the night before. In the kitchen, police found John Price's head boiling in a pot of vegetables on the stove. On the table, they found two full plates, each labeled with a name. The police realized that Katherine planned to serve John Price's body parts to his own children. Despite her claims that she didn't remember anything about the night John Price died, Katherine Knight was quickly charged with his murder. In October of 2001, her trial commenced, but it didn't get very far. For reasons that remain unclear, Katherine Knight changed her plea to guilty and the judge adjourned the case without testimony. She was escorted to prison and the judge ordered that her papers be marked never to be released. For the first time in history, a woman in Australia was given a life sentence without parole. To this day, Katherine Knight maintains her innocence and refuses to accept responsibility for her actions. She appealed her sentence before and was denied almost immediately. She is still serving her life sentence at Silverwater Women's Correctional Center. Oh my God. Have you heard of Katherine Knight before? Well, I'm quite sure that you've heard because this was extensively covered already, but oh my God, just think about how you never have any idea who you're marrying. But I think that we should actually learn a lesson from this. Whenever you see a woman keeping her butcher knives in her bedroom next to her bed, that's a red flag. It's a no-no from the start. Just, you know, get out of there whilst you still can, because it's a No. Anyway, this is all from me for today's video. Thank you guys so much for watching. Please give this video a thumbs up. It's free to do so. It doesn't cost you anything. It also helps me a lot with my channel and with the engagement on the video. The more likes I get, the more YouTube will spread the video on the platform. Again, thank you so much, guys. Stay safe and take care. Bye.